What is up, Dan? And sideways, all you absolutely beautiful individuals. Welcome to another episode of the Gun Mark. Eric and Mark here with you guys for a mix of different things in the bag to talk about today, because we do have not just one, we got two tournaments going on right now that are actually maybe more exciting than I was anticipating. And of course, we begin with the Los Ratones making the grand finals at the NNO tournament, beating the French Flair, five French players that obviously has Adam on that list. And again, they continue to pull insane numbers. And I think people, myself included, still absolutely loving getting full access to a team's comms, even if this isn't a full tier one team. Just seeing the insight to pick and ban and how they talk in game, it's a treat.
On the Los Ratones revolution, it continues. Viva la revolución of Los Ratones. Yes, my man, they keep rolling on through. Didn't have the Baus getting solo bolos against Adam on the bingo card heading
and
into the tournament.
And 1v4s? Oh my god.
Pretty impressive stuff from your boy in the top side. Yes, this has been a wonderful little revolution in the scene of League of Legends, getting Los Ratones, getting the access, the exposure, the content that everyone has been wanting from, and I think has been in a little bit of a drought since the early era of League of Legends, back when we would have, you know, these gaming house tours and, you know, TSM Legends was at the very forefront of content creation, these type of things. Something like Los Ratones jumping into the scene, the access that you are provided as a viewer to everything behind the scenes and really feel involved because of having that access to the content is something totally different. And it is so exciting and so fun to get to talk about this Los Ratones experiment.
And listen, their comps have been pretty clear. Obviously, you know, Nemesis, Crowny, and Caedrel. Caedrel's slipping into what will eventually be that coaching role once Reckless actually comes over, but seems to be doing great at it. And honestly, seeing all this has kind of made me think it'd be, and I've thought about this before, but it'd be so interesting. You know, you've seen this in like the World of Warcraft Mythic speed runs where you have kind of the shot caller of the raid not actually playing, right? They're just talking. I know this is in other esports too. I wonder if down the line you might have a coach actually get a headset in League to be able to guide the players and shot call through, because Caedrel in a role like that, I think, would be fantastic.
I think that would be something extremely exciting, a different angle and another addition to the game of League of Legends. You absolutely are going to have your people on their couches, you know, in their gaming chairs, whatever, screaming and saying, I don't like that, because of the way that it is going to change the way you look at the past era of the game, because I think that is a substantial change, adding someone on that outside. You think of other professional sports, right? Look at all of them. They have that coach. He has access to talk to the players during the plays, during the game. In the NFL, you have the headset in the helmets. NBA, the coach is right there on the sideline of the court.
They're on the court usually screaming, yes.
Exactly. So they're right there helping, giving that advice, coaching these players up, all those sorts of things. And I think that League of Legends is another competition where you can have that additional value. We know part of that is then going to be balancing, well, what is the viewer perspective going to be? Because, you know, being in from the perspective of a player and then changing to observer is already drastically different and provides another additional avenue of information. So that would be something I'd be cautious with. But I think this is an early conversation starter for something like that within League of Legends, and eventually will be the evolution of the pro scene in my eyes.
And, you know, I understand that takes away some of the greatest attributes and strengths that players have, is being able to play and shot call. You know, that's what some of the biggest weaknesses are on teams that have these mechanically gifted players, but they don't have that sense of what to do on the map, how to move around. So if you have a coach who's designated doing that, I mean, you would feel like the level of teams would raise up because they could be more focused on their individual play.
It places that additional value on the coach and another skill set that you have to have in order to reach your players, get that communication across in the right way, right time, all these type of things. I think that is an additional value to start evaluating and looking at teams and where their value is and their skill sets and whatnot. I would like to see that added for coaches. But don't think that that's something where we wouldn't see that agency, that ability of shot calling and decision making from players diminished in any type of way, because you look at those examples that I provided, the NFL, the NBA, NHL, where you have these coaches, you know, professional soccer, football, whatever it is, you have the coach there providing that insight, providing that, you know, the coaching and everything else. You still have these amazing players, these big moments where you find out, I made an audible, I made a change, I did something different in the call because I knew in my gut, I knew in my instinct of the game, whatever it is, and it makes it even better, that appreciation of these moments. I think that we would still see that in League of Legends where you're going, oh, you know, coach was calling, oh, go do these jungle camps or go back and buy this item. I said, no, I needed this item because it was going to let me do this or whatever. Still would have those type of moments.
And, you know, for now, it's just about the transparency that we're seeing with the comms on this squad. Again, if they end up scrimming against LEC teams, we know that's not going to be released. But the trajectory for this team is already ludicrous. The numbers that are pulling in for this four-fun tournament, and they've already secured their spot at this upcoming Red Bull event in a couple of weeks. That's going to, of course, have T1, G2, K-Corp, and the like. So the branding for Caedrel and the boys is... it's off the charts.
If I'm the LEC, I'm very quickly calling up Mr. Mark Z of the LTA and saying, okay, so exactly how did you figure out getting in, you know, one of these guest spot teams type of situations? Because you need Los Ratones in as soon as possible. Because if you don't, the LCS is calling and we're bringing all that import money to say, yes, we need to import the viewership of Los Ratones to the LCS for the guest spot. That would be something really special. I think the LEC needs to recognize that pretty soon.
And Caedrel has said he was, you know, in thinking about maybe looking at the LTA when he was looking at this squad. But no question, the NLC, the league that they will be playing in, is watching all this growth, all this interest, and they're just rubbing their hands saying, our league has been irrelevant for years, but now people are going to be paying attention coming into this year.
And even more so, building off of this hype again, this is with Caedrel as the support. He's going to move into that head coaching role, which brings in its own level of excitement and conversation about how he's going to operate in that and all the theories and game crafting that comes through from the way that he talks through pick and ban and everything else.
But their support doesn't have any fans, right? That's coming in.
Yeah, he's coming in as a little bit of a no-name. Oh, wait, it's Reckless stepping into the bottom lane, getting both those fists ready for the tattoo pose. He is going to be another addition for this team of obviously his personality, his insight, and everything else that will come through, and that fan base will be back there with them. Los Ratones, it is a mega hit, and it's only going to keep growing.
It really kind of dwarfs and shadows what's going on at the Kespa Cup, because it's actually been the most interesting Kespa Cup. I mean, maybe the coverage has been better, but usually I'm really not paying attention, but it's been a lot more interesting, and I touched on it before, you know, the patch is going to be completely outdated that they're playing on by the time the next season kicks off. But how about today, the bros, the new look OK Savings Bank Brayon, getting a win against D plus Kia to advance to the next round. And listen, they've got Hype, who people thought were going to be promoted from KT to be their starting AD carry. Closer's coming over. We know Lord Morgan is here. Paulu is now the de facto 18-year-old starter at support. Maybe we're tentatively excited for Bro. I don't know.
Cautious optimism for the bros to be able to succeed in the improbable run to the impossible playoff position that is for OK Savings Bank Brayon. This was a pretty fun little series, little matchup that we did get here. I think, again, one of the important ones to keep track of for a lot of people is B plus Kia is bringing the real roster. They're rolling
all
on out.
Starters.
It ain't no backups. It ain't no prospect. It is full on the real deal thing. And yes, I know we got rookies and Lucid as a sophomore stepping in on this lineup, but still it is going to be the real deal LCK crew. And to get dismantled, taken down by the bros, you like to see that early good signs for the bros.
And the other upset was KT with, again, pretty much their full challenger lineup taking down Hanwha Life, who isn't the full starting five, still waiting for Zeus to make the debut. But you got Zekka, Delight, and Viper on the squad, so I know there's actually nothing to take from Kespa of real substance heading into the season, but two big upsets on the day.
I think the only thing that I really do take away from this one is maybe about kind of just how crucial, how much of a player Peanut is in the operation of this Hanwha Life team, and how you're able to extract the very best from players like Zekka, from Viper, set them up in positions where they can then succeed and show their skill. Peanut, I think a very vital part of what that will be for Hanwha Life. And then, yes, again, still playing the waiting game for Zeus. I don't think anybody was really expecting that we would see it here this early at the Kespa Cup. You could still hope for it, but no Zeus sightings yet.
It's not dramatic enough for him to make his Hanwha debut in the Kespa Cup. It's gotta be that week one of the LCK after seeing the teaser video. But I touched on this the other day. Obviously, T1 quickly eliminated, winless at the Kespa Cup. Mark, you know, get rid of the panic for people. Everyone's saying, oh my God, there's no sub options for T1. What if something happens? We should be worried heading into the year. Chill.
I think, where were these people any of the other years that have been around for T1 rolling on through? They always have had a relatively empty type of wallet in that situation when you're looking at the secondary options for this team. Maybe, you know, you can talk about a couple years where you had someone like, oh, you had Kana, and then you had Zeus in that pipeline coming on up. That's not the situation, very clearly, with this T1 team. And even if you go back last year, I think we had, you know, Guan stepped up from the jungle position one or two times, I think, for the T1 team. Didn't necessarily impress throughout his challenger run, and still, you know, yes, he contributed during the playtime on the LCK stage. Still, nothing crazy. You'd be looking at Smash as that guy being the one that you would feel that confidence in. Gumayushi's in front of him. Well, who's next up? Well, it's the sometimes greatest of all time, Pobi, stepping into the mid lane. And he's, of course, yes, re-signed for this one. And he's bringing some of that experience, some of that exposure at that type of level, and filling in for the greatest of all time in Faker. You still don't have to have that type of same pull. And even then, Reckless isn't here anymore. Another solid option that could have been to replace someone like Kyria. So, yes, it does look a little bare behind the front lines of T1. But again, we all know T1 is all about that front line. It's all about those starters that are going to be there.
And really, the only one you might want actual break time for is Faker. And Pobi's probably right there with Smash as the most reliable, despite all the memes of him in the past. But the only reason you want one maybe for Faker is obviously the health issues, the wrist, making sure it's tip-top. Even though it sounds like he's gone through so many different training regimens and has completely changed how he plays, how he sits and everything. So feel like it'll be less of an issue, hopefully, going forward for him.
Yeah, but it absolutely is something that I think, even, you know, being as respectful and as hopeful as you could be, is something that T1 should be preparing themselves for, right? You do need to be not caught with your pants down in one of these situations, right? I'm unfortunately a fan of the Miami Dolphins, right? You got a quarterback that goes down with a concussion. You don't got anyone backing him up when you knew your guy was possible for concussions. Faker, you know it's possible that maybe he's going to have some wrist issue, needing some time off. You better have a capable fill-in. And I think, yes, despite what people might say in some negative aspects of some of the exposure early, Pobi can fill that one in. And the big thing for me that is that reassurance is more time with the T1 organization, with those T1 starters, and especially seeing behind the scenes the way that they interact with him and bring him up to their level. I've got no issues with Pobi being that replacement.
I think the truth is T1 exiting early, they're just getting ready for that Red Bull event, you know, that they wanted to scrim against that challenger scene to warm up for the likes of KC and Los Ratones over in Paris, where that one is going to be held. Seen some posts about this, and with the resurgence of WoW Classic new season getting underway for anyone that's paying attention to that, got me thinking about the age-old question of a League of Legends Classic. You know, apparently, and I remember there were inklings of some guys trying to develop Chrono Break, which was essentially League of Legends Classic, before Riot said, no, cease and desist. Not only are we not going to make this, but you can't make it either. But the idea of being able to play some decade-old League of Legends with completely different champions, bringing the level of play and mechanics that people have nowadays back to then, that'd be a fun time. Come on.
It's going to go one of two ways. It's either going to be incredibly scary, because taking the skill sets that have been honed in and sharpened in what is the 200 years of Riot game design era of League of Legends would be very different stepping on back in time to the original, the OG era and the different metas that we went through. Or it's going to be one of these ones where everything is so simple, so dumbed down, so basic that they don't know what to do. It is in they're in need, they need an outlet for that skill, for that twitchy action or something like that, where they don't get it in that original game. Would be a fun time. I think there's a lot of things to discuss when you're bringing up that idea of League of Legends Classic and exactly what League of Legends Classic is to everybody, because it's going to be a different answer, I feel.
Yeah, and again, this is where you can look at the success of WoW Classic and maybe try and rip some things off. I know it's, I'm imagining it's very difficult to just, it's not like they have these old versions of the game sitting there that they can just load up and put live on the client. I understand there'd be a lot of technical issues that would have to go into this, but I'm pretty sure if it's included in some kind of battle pass or you have someone pay a fraction of what they pay for skins to be able to access an entirely different wave, that it could cycle through like WoW Classic. All of a sudden you've got Burning Crusade, Cataclysm Classic. They got like four expansions deep being Classic. So yeah, you could go through Season 1, Season 2, Season 3. It could rotate and you're reliving all these different metas throughout the years until you basically reach the previous year, right? That's
let me paint a picture for you. It's 2026. We're approaching Worlds. Faker and his robotic hand, it's been replaced now. We've got the technology. I know it's only a short amount of time, but we've got this.
It's moving fast, yeah.
Yeah, and yet he's able to swap different screens three times as fast now as before. So he's working on through, and he's at that finals, and here comes the announcement, the sequel to the hit animated League of Legends series on Netflix, Nox Kane, Season 1. We're working on the working title for the name of it, of where we're going for it. And coming alongside it, League of Legends Classic. That's the announcement that you make. That's how you bring it back. That's how you bring that many people, because that's one thing that I think needs to be discussed and needs to be recognized with this. Yes, you know, maybe if you're talking with a couple of your friends as you're queuing up for an ARAM or jumping into TFT, whatever it is, your solo queue partner, whatever it's going to be, you go and you say, hey, you know, what about League of Legends Classic? That'd be fun. You need a lot more than just that guy, that girl to talk to that says, yeah, that League of Legends Classic would be cool. You need the numbers to back it up, the money to back it up, to get a project like this going. I think that that is possible, but we do need to be aware that, again, these type of things can't be supported without that type of push and that sustained push from the fan base.
Are you telling me people wouldn't want the resurgence of the, you know, Bowser Rammus skin, all these super old skins that you could only get by liking Riot on Facebook or something, UFO Corky going way back then, get a shot at getting these skins again? But yeah, as a for fun mode, even people who didn't play back then, because I mean, the youngins playing now, obviously they weren't paying 15 years ago when this game was coming out, but go back and seeing the OG AP Scion that only has two buttons that you have to actually press, and you don't even level up your ulti because it's useless for AP, like, that's a trip down memory lane.
I think it's something that's probably been discussed before with League of Legends, just not having that access to go back where you always have to play that current edition. Or maybe, you know, heck, if you really want to say that there's a little bit of variety, you can go to the PvE front where you're playing that next one up type of situation. You don't really get to roll the clock back and go backwards in time and say, you know what, even if unbalanced and whatever, let's have fun. Let's play an Ardent Censor meta type of game. Let's do a, you know, whatever type of thing and have fun. You can't do that type of situation where obviously a League of Legends Classic would be in something of that vein. Now, it would be one of those discussions of, okay, are you having it where there's multiple different eras, different classics of this game available at the same time in different playlists, different play game modes, whatever? Is it going to be one standard one where it says, hey, you want to play Classic? We're playing this era. And for if you don't like that era, you don't have good memories of it, well, you're going to have to come back in 6 months before we roll out the next patch or the next era that was going to be coming through type of situation. That would be something I think is obviously in consideration.
Yeah, I mean, rotating through the different seasons I think would be amazing. Otherwise, you'd probably just go full OG Classic, like beta era when it was at maximum jank. And you don't even, again, this is some stuff that when other classic or, you know, redos of games, you expect the jank to be there from a game that's 15 years old, 20 years old in some of these other cases. But all these different franchises, not just World of Warcraft, how many games are being remastered and redone? This doesn't even need to be a remastering. You want to keep it as it was, but like Last of Us has been remastered twice.
That's a separate discussion where that's a little crazy that that one's going on. But yes, I think it is one of these ones where there is something for a live service to be able to maintain that singular software and keep it going. There is also something to be said from putting on a number two on the box or a number three, going with that LOL Classic Edition, all these type of things to bring people back in, to have a new jumping point would be something for a lot of people. Again, I'm just still brought back into that idea of the experience of the traditional League of Legends, back rolling back the simplicity on a lot of these things, and still then having the visual fidelity that we do have in the current League of Legends, the current designs of these champions and the skins. That would be something that I would go for. I think a lot of these people, if you could say, hey, you can earn this rare, exclusive, old type of skin, and you know what? Here's this special chroma or this limited edition chroma that says, you got it, you were here for the classic, for the revision of what was an iconic time in League of Legends history.
And that's the secret to get people involved, is to get them a limited time offer skin that you have to do it here. But, you know, the other option is just to relive every different Rise rework. You know, I would settle for that just to be able to play all 15 versions of them.
That was my other question. Then are we going with the route of, okay, well, you're playing in this era of League of Legends. That means that you're playing with this edition of this champion type of thing, and does that mean that I gotta go, okay, man, I'm loading up into League of Legends Classic, let me flip through the dictionary book here, okay, it's Rise edition number 7, okay, yep, remembering that one. Oh no, this week it's Rise number 2, okay, he does this, that would be a little bit wonky. But again, that jank, that wonkiness, that's gonna be there.
We're
bringing back, it's going to be there, and what you're bringing back in a project like that, and some of that jank, some of that imbalance, that's where the fun is to be had.
Still probably just a pipe dream for now, League of Legends Classic, but who knows, it might end up coming out before the Riot MMO, so just keep manifesting, keep hoping for the best, everybody. But that is it today for League Unlock. Eric and Mark here with you, beautiful people. Thanks for hanging out, and we will catch you on that flippity flip.